Okay, we'll continue on from last lectures, materials, sets, and maps. As I told you before, today we're going to make sets and maps efficient in this class. And that is hashing is how we're going to make sets and maps efficient. So we would like to build efficient sets and dictionaries. And dictionaries is another name of maps. And in fact, a set is really a dictionary where items are keys. So set is a special kind of dictionary without values. Thus, in this class, we'll focus on dictionaries. And we could solve numerous problems with dictionaries. For example, we can implement databases and compilers and interpreters require dictionaries because we need to convert names to variables. And when we are building network routers, we need to convert IP addresses to wires. So we need dictionaries. And for network servers, we need to convert port numbers into sockets. Therefore, dictionaries are perhaps the most popular data structure in CS. So how do we build an efficient dictionary? The goal is to make the following operations O1. So we want to make find operation, find the item with the key K in a dictionary. And we want to do this operation in the time complexity of O1. And we also want to insert an item with the key K in O1. And we want to delete an item with the key K in O1. In the last class, we saw that find operation takes longer time than O1. And how can you make these operations O1? The solution is we are going to use random access memory, also abbreviated as RAM. You might have heard of this. When we use RAM, we can retrieve any item in constant time once we know the address of the item. So that is how the RAM hardware is working. That means if we use random access memory, then O1 is achieved. And to utilize RAM, because we need to know the address of the item, we need to associate a semantic meaning or key with each array location or address, right? That is one thing we need to resolve to use RAM to implement efficient dictionaries, all right? So in the following slides, we're going to talk about how we can utilize random access memory to implement dictionaries. And there are actually two problems of the naive RAM approach. The first one is, as in the last class, I told you that keys can be any objects. We could input like numbers or strings or objects. We can actually use anything existing in Python as keys. Thus, how do we associate keys with each memory location can be a big problem. Another problem is the range of possible keys is very huge. Say it's like 2 to the power of 10,000 or more than this, because keys can be any objects. And that means there are a huge number of possibilities that any objects can come into key positions. And to associate each key with memory space, we need large memory space. Otherwise, we are not going to be able to associate each possible key with the memory space location. So how are we, so there are going, and another problem with this is there are going to be some unused memory space, and this will result in inefficient memory usage. So how are we gonna resolve these two issues, these two problems? The first one is called prehash. This method converts keys to integers. In other words, prehash converts any objects into integers. And to resolve the second problem, we're going to use hashing. Hashing is a method to reduce the space of all keys, say all integers, down to reasonable size M for table or small memory space. Okay, so here you can see two words, hashing and hash. And I'll define these two terms by defining hash or hash function in the following slides. So to summarize, we want to make dictionaries very efficient, and that could result in efficient sets. So we are going to focus on dictionaries. And to make dictionaries efficient, we are going to use random access memory, because if we know the address of a location, then we can access that item in O1. So that is how we are going to make efficient, build efficient dictionaries. In the space of all keys, we're going to use U to indicate the space of all keys. And this U is a very, very large number because it represents the number of possible objects, which is infinite, almost infinite. So what is hashing? Here, I'm going to show you the big picture of hashing. Hashing is actually, as in the last slide, reduce the space of all keys down to reasonable size M. So let's say U is 1000 and M is like 20. And this hash function given key converts this given key into smaller set of numbers, all right? So we call this function hash function or hash map. This is the term. And here K is the key, and key can be any object. However, we are going to pre-hash all the objects, and all the objects will be converted to integers. So here you can think of K as integers. And integers can have the values from 0 to U-1. And this U is a very large number. And this hash function will convert this key integer into smaller number. And we say the result of HK is the hash of integer K, all right? So this is the term we are defining. And we say these numbers from 0 to M-1 in total M numbers as hash table, okay? So this is the picture. Let's say the space of all keys or all integers we're going to use, or keys of interest, is U. And we have from 0 to M-1 table, say we have this amount of memory space. Okay? And you can think of this as the memory space of RAM, random access memory, all right? And let's say there are some keys inside this space, and this key is mapped to the position 0. This one is to M-2. And this one is going to be mapped to the position 0. This is straightforward because we have much larger number of U, and M is smaller than U. So this mapping is not one-to-one. However, collision occurs. So some keys might be mapped to the same point, same memory location like this. So what I want to say through this slide is we can use RAM to make dictionaries efficient. However, because we are using hashing, there might be some collisions occurring. And we need to resolve this collision issue to move on. And how do we deal with collisions? The first approach is using chaining. And the second approach is open addressing. And we're going to have a look at these two methods to deal with collisions. Chaining is a simple method. It is very straightforward and intuitive. We are going to use linked list of colliding elements in each slot of table. So let's say these three keys are mapped at the same point like this. And rather than saving just one element here, we are going to save linked list and connect other elements as follows. So let's say this one is K1, K2, and K4. And these three elements are going to be linked using linked list. And the hash of K1 and hash of K2 and hash of K4 are the same. So they are mapped to the same point. And let's say another point is mapped to this position. And we're going to create a node and save this value here. Another thing you need to note here is we are having two slots in each linked list node. The first one, we're going to save the key. And for the second slot, we're going to save some values. If you do not save values here, then it is going to be sets. Okay. So this is chaining method to resolve the collision issue. And let's implement this linked list hash together and see how they work. Okay, let's run this first. So the first part is we are going to use chaining to implement hash, right? And because we are going to use linked list, we need to implement node class first. And this node class is very simple. And we are familiar with this one. As I told you, this node needs to save three things. The first one is key, and the second thing is value, and the third thing is the pointer to the next node. And we can put the default value none here, like this. Although we haven't talked about hash function in depth, we are going to use a simple hash function. Here we are going to use just modulo operation to define hash, like hash function like this. And in the later of this lecture, we are going to have a look at what kind of hash functions are good and what kind of hash functions are bad. Right? So at the moment, just think that this hash function works quite good for our purpose. And now let's implement the dict class. So we first need to define the constructor. And let's say we have only 100 memory slot. The memory space we have is 100. Let's assume this. And because this one is dictionary, we want to provide the contain functionality. If this key is inside this dictionary or not. And to do that, we're going to use self find node key. So if we could find a node with this key, then it contains, this dictionary contains this key. Otherwise, it is not containing this key, okay? And we're going to define the find node method. And this find node method will receive the key and find the position of this key. And as in this figure, we first need to go to the memory slot corresponds to this key and search through the linked list and then check if these key values are same as the given key, all right? So the first thing is we need to find the hash position and then compare the key values. So if this key is inside this dictionary or not. Okay, so the first thing is find the memory position and then compare the values inside the linked list. And let's implement that together. We first need to find the memory position using this hash function. So this one is to find the memory location first. And this memory location contains linked list. And this one is going to be the head of the linked list at memory position, memory location I. All right. And what we are going to do is we just travel through the linked list. So while P is not none, if p jump p dot key is equal to the given key, then we're going to return p. Otherwise, we go to the next position, next linked list, and search through the values inside this key, right? And if nothing was found corresponding to the given key, we return none. So we can check this dictionary contains this key or not using this find node method. Okay. And we are going to define get item method like this. So this one is like dictionary key. And it's going to return the value of the item, the key K, okay? And let's implement this together. We first need to find the node with this key. And we can use our find node method, implement an array. And this method will find the node, linked list node, that contains this key value. And if p is not none, then we're going to return the value of p. Otherwise, we're going to erase the value error. And the last method we're going to define is setItem method. The setItem method receives key and value. Let's say we want to put some value with this key. All right, this is our first PPP exercise.